sometimes water down the gospel, if we speak it at all, just so we can make people feel more comfortable. Maybe just tell people about the love of God, the mercy of God, the grace of God, and we leave out the hard things like the wrath of God and the judgment of God, so we don't feel too uncomfortable. Maybe we try not to offend them. Remember doing a friend's father's funeral. His mom and dad grew up with my mom and dad. I grew up with him. And it was difficult for me because I knew that the son was an atheist. I knew he had no relationship with God. I knew that the deceased man had no relationship with God. And the first thing he told me was, I don't want you to speak about Jesus at the funeral. I don't want nothing religious in it. I'm a pastor, and I had to be honest with him. I said, I'm not going to do the funeral and tell you that I'm not going to speak about Jesus. I can't do that. But as much as it is, as much as it's hard for me to admit, it wasn't the key point of the message like it normally is. I spoke very little. They did a lot of speaking. And sometimes it's hard. You know, I told him, I've got to tell about Jesus Christ, but you have to balance the family's wishes, and it just gets hard. But at his mother's funeral, his mother used to be very close to God, and there's a really good chance that even though she lived most of her life not serving God at all, at the end of her life, she rededicated her life in the last hours. There's a very good chance of that. So the family convinced him, because not everybody in the family was an atheist, that we should have a more traditional family, or more traditional message for his mother. Now, the verse that I chose, and I chose it for many reasons, was from from the book of Romans. And the reason I chose it, because I knew that this couple, I just did his dad's funeral 6 months ago, now I'm doing his mom's funeral, they were the family that we all hung out with when we were younger and we were in high school. I mean, everybody met there. We'd have, and the reason was, you know, let me tell you the reason was, is they let us drink alcohol. You know what I mean? Now, before you judge them too harshly, keep in mind, when I graduated high school, the legal drinking age was 18, and most of us were either 18 or close to 18, but they let us have parties at their house, and sometimes maybe 200 or 300 people there. And you put alcohol out with a class of seniors, and everybody shows up. But they would join us, you know. It was a great time. But they would cook big dinners on Sundays, and we would come over, and they were big hunters, and they had, you know, so we had all kinds of game. And they liked to play poker, and my friends liked to play poker. So it was just a house we hung out with. And a lot of us, as we grew older, we remained friends with them. In fact, we remained friends with them up until the day they died. So I knew there was going to be a lot of my high school friends there. And if they'd not gone to his dad's funeral, they would have no clue that I was a pastor, because most of them remember me from the times I was at their house, you know what I mean? So, and I wasn't honoring God with my actions there. I also knew, because, you know, I keep up with a lot of people that don't know I keep up with them just because I'm friends with other people and ask, that most of them didn't know Jesus Christ at all. And I'm thinking to myself, how can I get this unchurched group to grow closer to God? So I chose this verse. I chose Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10. Paul letters to the Romans and Christians, what we now know as the book of Romans, and it reads like this. If you declare with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, then you will be saved. For it's with the heart that you believe, and you are justified. And it's with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. And like Kyle said, I had great intentions. I knew I was speaking before an unchurched crowd. I wanted them to come to Jesus. They knew me. I knew them, or at least the majority of them. So I began talking about this. Confess with your mouth. Make Jesus your Savior. And like I said, my intentions were absolutely honorable. They were good. I thought I did a pretty good job. I'm driving home, and I find out God is not happy with me. He began to speak to my heart in a pretty convicting way. He was sort of chastising me. He said, is that what my word really says? Did you preach it like the word that are in the scripture? Were you trying to bring people to me, or were you just trying to be popular? Now, when God tells you that will put something heavy on your heart. Were you afraid that you were going to offend somebody with my word? I don't think that verse said what you said it says. So when I went home, I went back and I reread it. And I had to repent. And I tried not to do it again, although I know I probably have. Verse doesn't say declare with your mouth Jesus Christ is Savior, does it? It says declare with your mouth Jesus Christ is Lord.
Amen.
And there is a lot of difference between making Jesus your Savior and making Jesus your Lord. Because if you make Jesus Christ your Savior, you can do anything you want to do. You can say Jesus is my Savior and you can act any kind of way you want. But when you say Jesus Christ is my Lord, now you're saying I got to do what he tells me to do. I got to act like he tells me to act. I got to do the things he tells me to do. If you say Jesus Christ is your Lord, then you have to obey his commands. Like Kyle said, I mean, I don't want you to get this wrong. Like Kyle said, the unconditional joy, the peace that passes all understanding, the grace and the mercy of God, the things that free us from guilt and shame, these are truths and they need to be spoken of, and they need to be spoken of often. But here at the Odyssey Church, I just want you to have the full counsel of the gospel. I want you to know the entire message of the scriptures, not just one part of it. And that's why sometimes you get a series of messages like the ones we've been doing for the last couple of weeks. And I know at times I've cheapened the gospel with verses like Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 11. I mean, I've preached at funerals. I've preached it at other churches. I've preached it at revival services. But if all you have to do is confess Jesus as your Savior, it's different than confessing him as Lord and believing in your heart that Jesus Christ raised him from the dead. Some people just confess Jesus as a Savior, live any kind of way they are, and you think you're safe and you think you're in. But that's not what the scripture says. As I looked at this verse with fresh eyes, it says, declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord. And that's not so easy. Following Jesus isn't always attractive and as appealing as some pastors make it out to be. There is a cost to following Jesus, but there is a cost to anything worthwhile.
Amen.
If you're married and you love your spouse, there are costs that come involved. If you have kids and you love your kids, there's costs that are involved. If you have a job and you love your job, there's costs that are involved. Anything worthwhile is going to come at some kind of cost. And we love to hear the scriptures about love and God's encouragement and God's grace and God's mercy. And we need to hear them, and we should hear them. And we should love to hear them. But we also need to hear those things, and we need to hear them often, that teach the whole counsel of the gospel. We need to hear about the love of God, but we also need to hear about what God expects from us so that we can be saved from his wrath and have eternal life with him. And keep this in mind. You know, this is not me preaching to it, please. This is God ministering to my heart. I just get to say what God tells me out loud to you. But this is God ministering to me, and I hope he ministers to you as well. But I probably need to be reminded of this more often than most of you do. And in case you haven't been here, here's the overriding theme of this entire message, of this whole series, fan or follower. It comes from Luke 9:23. Then he said to them all, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny himself and take up their cross daily and follow me. We have to deny, pick up our crosses and follow him. So what do we do? Well, you know, the question becomes, what do we do as these humans who are comfort-craving Christians? What do we do with verses like this? I mean, it's pretty much hard to avoid the cross when you're a Christian, right? It's in our human nature to be comfortable. As Christians, what happens sometimes is we find a way to make the cross comfortable, don't we? I mean, it's in our human nature to want comfort. The cross is in Scripture. We want to be good Christians, so we start to compromise. We start to find a way to make this cross comfortable. And come on, I love it. You know, that example he gave meant so much to me because I've got three daughters. I've got a son. You talk about, you know, growing up and then wanting to get married. He said, imagine it this way. And like I said, this was good exercise for me. I've got three daughters. Imagine if one of them grows up and they desire to be married. Now, I want you to know, I got a daughter that's 30. There's a difference between being 30 and being grown up, if you know what I mean. Maybe they see their friends getting married. maybe they start seeing children, they start to want the same thing. So I decided I'm going to help the process along. I'm going to call the WAVE, I'm going to call the Justice Guide, I'm going to call the News Journal, I'm going to call WBOC, I'm going to put an ad up, I'm going to put billboards up, and I'm going to put t-shirts out there, and I'm going to be begging somebody to come and marry my daughter. Now, Carl Adams says, wouldn't that cheapen who she is? Wouldn't that make it seem like they were doing her a favor? And like Kyle said, you know, I'd never do that. Doesn't mean I didn't think of it. Just means I wouldn't do it. And like Kyle, you know, I'm thinking, if you want to marry one of my children, it doesn't matter whether it's my son or my daughter, if you want to marry one of them, I want you to come with all you got. I don't want you to say to them, listen, I'll give you a couple hours a week. You know, one or two days a week I'll give you, but the rest of the time I'm going to do what I want to do. I want that person to come and say, listen, I'll lay down my life for my child. I'll lay down my life for my son or my daughter. I want them to give up all they have to them. And I want them to give all they have back in return. Now, sometimes Christianity becomes the same way. We cheapen Christianity when we start to beg people to take Jesus. And in my heart, I have such a desire that people follow Jesus. I think I probably make this mistake more often than not, because I truly believe that this is an eternal life issue. And most of us know it is, you know. Most of us know that it's a difference between eternal life of complete joy and eternal life of abundance and eternal death of, you know, doom and damnation. We get that. But this is not about heaven and hell. That's what we get wrong so often in churches. It's not just about heaven and hell. Yes, that's important. That's eternity. But what are you going to do with life right now? Are you going to live in abundance right now? Or are you living today thinking, well, I hope I get to heaven soon because I can't take this much more? And that's not what Jesus says.
Amen.
It's deeper than salvation. We're talking about walking and following Jesus, the Messiah, the anointed of God. So as comfortable Christians, what do we do with this verse like Luke 9:23? I mean, it's bad enough that Jesus says I have to, you know, pick up my cross. I mean, it's bad enough Jesus had to die on the cross, but he wants us to do the same thing. That's tough teaching. It's a tough sell. It's hard to build a church with a message like that. I mean, if you were in marketing, you'd never advertise Christianity that way, would you? You'd never put it on billboards. You know, come and deny yourself. Come and pick up your cross. You'd downplay that part of it. Especially about the part having to pick it up every day and following instead of leading. Like I said, you know, these messages are tough to speak, they're tough to hear, they step on my toes. But as I've been studying, I've been challenged. And challenge is good. Challenge makes you think. So I'm hoping as you're here and you become challenged as well, what you do with it is up to you. But what I'm finding out is it's not just enough to confess Jesus Christ. Jesus expects something from us. He expects commitment to Him. He expects us to deny Himself and to follow Him. Jesus expects us to be more than fans. Or as we put it last week, He expects us more than to be just Christians. He expects us to be disciples. And we don't have to pick up our cross. He doesn't tell us to pick up the cross one time. He says pick it up every day. Pick it up all the time. Not one time, and to follow Him. To be more than fans, to be more than Christians, to be somebody who truly follows, to be a disciple, learning from their master. And I think today God wants to challenge us with three very uncomfortable verses. Probably some of the most uncomfortable verses which are found in the Scripture. And yet, that's just, why would God want to do that? Because He loves you. Simple as that, because He loves you and He wants one from each of us to be more than fans. He wants all of us to have this deep, devoted, totally committed followers of His Son, Jesus Christ. He loves us so much, He wants to spend eternity with us. So He wants us to mold us into the image of Jesus Christ. But even more importantly than that, right now, He wants to be molded. He wants us to be molded into the image of Jesus Christ so that we can live abundantly now. We forget that. It's about right now, right here on this earth. All three of these verses are found in the same chapter. They're found in the Gospel of Luke chapter 14. And if you have your Bibles, you can turn there now. But if not, I'm going to be reading. I'm going to start with verse 26 in the Gospel of the Gospel of Luke chapter 14, verse 26. And you know, as I read these, and they were pointed out to my heart, because sometimes I read the whole chapter and just sort of glance over them, la, la, la. But as they were pointed out of my heart, I mean, I started thinking, oh, God, I really wish You didn't put that in there. That's pretty tough. Can't we just write? don't know if y'all know the Thomas Jefferson Bible. Thomas Jefferson, anything he didn't like, he took a razor blade and just cut it out. I don't like that. Go to what? I do that with these verses. Maybe when you hear them, you might want to do the same thing. Today, I think God wants to challenge us with this. So let's start with this first one. This is what we're going to learn. First of all, let's take context of where we're at in the walk with Jesus and where he's at. As he's walking along, there are these large crowds. He's become very, very popular. So large crowds are following him everywhere that he's going. But now it's getting towards the end of his ministry. Jesus is starting to bring everything home. And he turns to him and he says, listen, a lot of you all, and I'm paraphrasing it, listen, a lot of y'all have been following me, and you've been following me because I've been doing some miracles, and you like that show, and the other day I fed 5,000 plus your wives and your children, I've been giving you some free food, and it's really cool to follow me because I've made you really, really comfortable, and I've sort of made some of you sort of popular. You've been following me for a show, but I got to tell you, I want you to go deeper. I need to start seeing some application in your life. I want you to start seeing some obedience from some of you. I want to start seeing some transformation. And Jesus begins to get very, very honest with them. He said, it's going to cost you something to follow me. Okay? It's not cost you anything up to this point. But now I'm telling you, I'm going to start expecting stuff from you. It's going to start expecting things from me. So this message is about three things. Superiority, submission, and sacrifice. Superiority, submission, sacrifice. Now, I want you to think about it. When's the last time, if you've been watching TV, Pastor, when's the last time you ever heard one talk about the superiority of God or maybe sacrificing anything but your money, and definitely not a lot about submission? But that's what God requires. So let's look at this first stroke. Submission. Luke 14:26. Follow along with me if you don't have it. It says, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his father, hate his mother, and hate his wife, and hate his children, hate his brothers, and hate his sisters. Yes, if they don't even hate their own life, such a person cannot be my disciple. You know, are we really willing to make Jesus superior to everything else to follow him, to be considered his disciple? And this verse right here, you know, I didn't realize it, but it's a controversial verse. A lot of people have some really strong things to say about this verse can be uncomfortable. Because what happens is people take it out of context. Right. Now that's why I think it's important that we come to church and we hear the message. It's important that we read our own Bibles. It's important that we read commentaries. It's important that we study. And it's more important to study when some of the verses can be, you know, maybe difficult to understand. Because at face value, on the superficial surface, you read this and go, what? What is he talking about here? You know, is Jesus teaching hate here? I mean, not just hate evil and not just hate sin, but he's talking about hate my mom and hate my dad and hate my children and hate my brothers and hate my sister, even hate my own life. Well, that doesn't seem like the love of Jesus that I hear so much about. And let me assure you something. Passages like this can be dangerous if they're used inappropriately. They can be dangerous if you don't understand the true meaning of what Jesus is actually saying. Used in the wrong way and used in the wrong context, things like this do a lot of damage. Example, you give a six-year-old, he don't know what it's used for. He doesn't know how to use it. So we have to be careful when we talk about verses like this. Jesus is not teaching hate. I want you to know, and I want you to be sure this isn't a teaching, and he's not telling these large crowds, he's not telling us to hate anybody. Jesus commands us to love everybody. In fact, he tells us to even love our enemy, and he's not going against the fifth commandment, which says, honor their mother and father. The Bible has no contradictions. Sometimes we just need to understand how it's interpreted. What this passage deals with is superiority. Your relationship with Jesus must be superior to all your other relationships. Now, wouldn't it be great if Jesus just come out and said that? Wouldn't it be great if he said, I got to be number one? Jesus comes out and says, you know, I need to be the number one thing in your life, not number two. But instead, he says, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, wife and children, even his brothers and sisters, even his own life, such a person cannot follow me. It'd be simpler if he said, I got to be number one. It'd make it easier to understand. And it probably would be. But here's the thing. Jesus is a master communicator.
Amen to that.
And it would have lost the impact of what he was trying to say. It got their attention. When Jesus used the word hate, we use what's called synecdoche hyperbole. Hyperbole is the use of exaggeration to make a point. And we use it all the time in our language, and they use it all the time in land language. Maybe you're like me. Your wife tells you something, and you think to yourself. Now, you think to yourself because you're wise enough not to say that out loud. I know, she's told me a million times. Now, she probably hasn't told you a million times. It just feels like it. It's hyperbole. One time when Taylor and Caleb, my youngest two, were, before they could drive, I think they were about 14 and 12, my daughter Taylor, the older one, had a job. I had one of those book fairs at school, and she bought my daughter a couple things. She bought her an eraser, she bought her a notebook, and bought her one of those ultraviolet pens that you could do secret writing with. So as we're riding home, they're in the back seat. That's because they would fight over the front seat. Everybody got to sit in the back. And she gets these presents, and she sees the book, and she thanks her. She gets the eraser, she thanks her. But when she gets the ultraviolet pen, she gets like, I've wanted one all my life! Now, being the good parent that I am, I said something like, Caleb, that is so great. I can't believe when you were 6 months old and you were in the crib, you wanted an ultralight pen, and now you finally got one. She said, Dad, I hate you. The fact of the matter is, she probably didn't hate me. She might have felt like it at the time, but she didn't really mean it. And she didn't want one for her entire life. She wanted one for a long time, but not for her entire life. Sometimes we just use words for exaggeration to make our point. Part of our everyday language is part of the everyday language at the time when Jesus walked with us. So Semitic hyperbole is mentioned in most scriptures. It's mentioned in the writings of the times, and it's mentioned in the writings of today's time. So it's not about hate. It's about superiority. Jesus says in Matthew 6:24, no one can serve two masters. Either will hate the one and love the other, or he'll be devoted to the one and despise the other. If I put my job, if I put my family, if I put anything above God, it's not that I hate my family or I hate my job or I hate those other things. It's just that I'm making my job, my family, or those other things superior to Jesus Christ. We put anything above Him, whether it's money, whether it's alcohol, whether it's even our own family before God, we move those things superior to God, and that breaks at least two of the Ten Commandments. Thou shalt not covet, thou shalt not have any idols. Jesus used these passages to get us to think. He gets them to stir the pot, to juggle up what you're saying, to evaluate our relationships, to evaluate the things in our life, to reveal to our hearts, is Jesus really superior to everything else? Is Jesus first? Is Jesus the one and only? Or is Jesus just one of many? These types of passages are simply to help us see where our priorities lay and who is superior in our lives and what to whom we're truly devoted to. And then the next verse, verse 26, deals with superiority. That deals with superiority. If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother and his wife, his children, his brother and sister, yes, even his own wife, such a person cannot be my disciple. Then in verse 27, it says this, and whoever does not carry their cross, again, he mentions the cross, and follow me, cannot be my disciple. I'm thinking to myself, okay, I'm going to make Jesus superior to my mom and dad, my brothers and sisters, my children, myself even. Now he's saying I got to pick up my cross? I got to make him superior to my job, my money, and all the... That's tough enough. But I got to pick up my cross and follow him? And this is the place in particular, I think, that we have watered down and made the cross comfortable. We forget that at the time that Jesus wrote this, Jesus had never gone to the cross. I put a question on Facebook this weekend, and I didn't get any responses, and to be honest with you, I didn't expect to get any responses. But the question was simply this. When you see a cross, what do you think? When you look around and you see a cross sitting up here, what do you think? Do you think of anything at all? Or has it just become so common that it just blends in to the habitat that it's in? But I want you to imagine something. Imagine you're a first century disciple, and you'd seen Jesus die on a cross. See, we made the cross comfortable. We wear it on our t-shirts. We wear it on our around our necks. We put them up in churches. Sometimes we have 2, 3, 4, 5 of them. We put decals on the back of our cars. We see it so often, we don't think anything about it. We think of one cross and one death. But Jesus hadn't gone to the cross when this took place. Everybody in his audience would have known what it meant to die on a cross. The Jews and the Romans, they all knew that it was the worst of the worst that were crucified on a cross. It was the worst kind of criminal that was given this excruciating death. And before they died, they were forced to carry their cross, the cross member, the instrument of their execution, to the place of their execution. First, they'd usually be beaten or whipped. And they'd be beaten and whipped to the point that sometimes you could see the vertebrae in their back where the skin had ripped loose. A lot of times the ribs would break and poke out through the side. The muscles would be torn. And this cross member, according to my research, weighed about 120 pounds. So after they're beaten, after they're whipped, they're forced to carry this cross member, this instrument of their execution, to the place of their execution. And we think of it, because we've seen it so often, that the church is, that the cross is set up way up high. Jesus is looking down at us, and we're looking up at Jesus. But the fact is, the crosses were only about 3 feet off the ground, 2 to 3 feet off the ground. Not much higher than this cross right here. And the reason they did that, so as the people were stretched out on the cross, you could look directly into their eyes. And you could see their pain.
Yes.
You could smell the blood in the air. You could hear them gasping for air. You could taste the fear and the death. You could look the person being crucified right in the eye. And the Romans would do this to show their power. But it was also a way that they would utterly humiliate the criminal. Because we see Jesus hanging on the cross with a cloth above him. He was stripped naked. They stripped him naked, hung him on the cross. And the death process was very, very long. That's why, if you read the scriptures, Pontius Pilate was so surprised when he learned that Jesus was dead, because it took usually days. You didn't die in a short period of time. They drove these nails through you, they beat you, they whipped you, but it wasn't the loss of blood, it wasn't the nails that killed you. You ended up dying of suffocation. Now imagine how much pain it took to have a nail driven through your legs and have to push yourself up to breathe. It took 2 or 3 days for people to die usually. And they put these crosses on very public roads. Sometimes you would ride down the road or walk down the road and you would see maybe 10, 15, or even 100 crosses. And you'd see people in different stages of death. That's why the Roman soldiers, we've seen in Scripture, broke their legs, because it would speed up the death process, because they no longer push themselves up, because usually they suffocated to death. So these first century disciples, if they were transported today into the future, and they see what we've made of the cross, what do you think they would think? We made the cross very comfortable, haven't we? So we look at this and we say, you know, this following Jesus is a little tougher than I thought. You know, first of all, he wants to make all my other relationships, everything I have, he wants to be superior to that, and then he wants me to pick up my cross and be submissive to him. I mean, this should challenge you. What I think Jesus is saying, remember, I'm just a messenger here. You know, these aren't my words. These are actually the words of Jesus. We can't say, well, Apostle Paul wrote that, so it doesn't have as much meaning. This was a prophet of old. We're now in the New Testament. These are the words of Jesus of him. And I think what he's saying is, you're either all in or you're all out. There's no middle realm. If you're in the middle, you're lukewarm. And Jesus tells us in the book of Revelation chapter 3, I know your deeds. I know that you're neither cold or hot. I wish you were one or the other. That verse confused me for a long time. Why would he wish that I was cold or hot? I mean, I understand the hot part, but why would he wish I was warm? Have you ever seen somebody who was cold get on fire for Jesus?
Yeah.
Have you ever seen somebody who's been sitting in the pews forever that used to do a lot for Jesus and had become lukewarm? It's easier to get somebody cold fired up than it is to get somebody sitting in the pews for a year that's warm to do anything.
Amen.
And if you're hot, he don't have to worry about you. Jesus calls us to make a choice. He says, you gotta go deeper, or you might as well turn back. It's either total submission or it's nothing. And that's tough. But that's the gospel. These are the words of Jesus himself. So, you know, sometimes we have to ask ourselves, am I all in? Am I making Jesus appear to everything else? I heard a quote this week. It says, you say you're willing to do anything for Jesus, and yet you can't even come to church 1 hour a week. Are you willing to submit? And the third and final point, chapter 14, verse 26, and we'll skip down to verse 33. In the same way, those of you who do not give up everything, you cannot be my disciples.
That's so true.
Three times in verse 14, he tells us what we have to do, and he says if we don't do it, we can't be his disciples. And I'm thinking to myself, Lord, first I have to make you superior to everything. Then I have to be submissive, even to the cross. And now you have to say, I have to give up everything? Give up everything? Are you crazy? I don't know about all that. Shouldn't my following Jesus just be proportionate to what I have? Should, but Jesus says, no, I want your following me to be proportionate to what you're willing to give up. And you think this, did Jesus really mean that we had to give up everything literally? Now, Jesus doesn't desire us to live in poverty. He says that he came to give us life and to give it more fully. But for some of us, like the rich young man in Scripture, for some of us, he may literally mean that we have to give up everything because everything is in place of him. If you were asked by Jesus, would you take the stance that I am willing to risk everything? I'm willing to risk my relationships. I'm willing to risk my job. I'm willing to risk the place that I live. I'm willing to risk everything. And that's tough. And for some of us, it may be little. But I don't think that's the case for all of us. For some of us, maybe it's just one thing. Maybe there is something in your life that is keeping you from being the disciple that Christ calls you to be. To being that deeply committed follower. You know, for me, I can only speak for myself. For me, for a long, long time, it was pride. I wanted to be this follower of Jesus, but I knew what it was going to cost me. I knew there were people in my life that wouldn't understand. I knew there were people in my life that would not want to hang around me anymore if I became a so-called Jesus freak. Maybe that's for you. Maybe that's what's keeping you. I'm going to tell you, that's going to happen. There'll be people that don't want to hang around you anymore when you become a Jesus freak. You know what? That's okay. What's really going to surprise you are the ones that stick around and the ones that leave. Some of the people that I thought were the most religious were the ones that left first.
Amen.
Maybe it's something material. And again, I can only speak for myself. That was me. I had a good job. I was making lots of money. And I knew some of the things I was doing in my job I didn't want to bring Jesus into. They were common practice. They were legal. But legal and moral, two different things.
Yeah.
Maybe it's a ghost from your past. And some of you here right now, are probably thinking to yourself, and you know exactly what it is. The question is, when you leave here today, will you do anything about it? She said, I might not ask you to give up anything, but I might. And if I do, are you willing? And not just some things, not just the easy thing. If I ask you, are you willing to give up everything? See, here's the thing. Do we hold on to our stuff with closed fists? Or do we hold on to our stuff with open hands? Which one do you think Jesus asks us to do? Are you willing to come to God? Are you willing to come to Christ and say, if you want every bit of my stuff, I'm willing to give it to you. And if you're willing to give me more and trust me more, I'm willing to take that too. But whichever way it goes, I'm all in. tired of being a fan. I'm tired of sitting here doing nothing. I'm going to get on the field. I'm going to be your hands and feet in the world. I'm yours. Everything I got is yours. Everything that I am is yours. It's all yours. I belong to you and I'm all in. See, we can't be preoccupied with our money. We can't be preoccupied with our possessions or with anything else and expect to receive the full measure of the abundant, passionate life Jesus wants to give us. To know Him instead of know about Him. He says, you want to know what's expected in order to have true joy in your discipleship with me? Well, then here it is. You make me, Jesus the Christ, superior to everything else in your life. You have to be willing to be submissive, even to the point of carrying your own cross. And you have to be willing to sacrifice everything if necessary. That's what it takes to be my disciple, to be a follower instead of a fan. See, Jesus never paints a rosy picture, but He does make us this promise in the Gospel of John, chapter 16, verse 33. He said, I told you these things so that you may have peace. In this world, you will have trouble. It doesn't say you may have trouble. It doesn't say you might have trouble. I've never met one person in my life that didn't have some kind of trouble in their life. But He says, I have overcome the world, so you take heart. It's about living an abundant life. And I want you to remember this. Jesus never asked any of us to do anything He wasn't willing to do Himself. It's about living an abundant life right now. Listen to these words found in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 29 through 30. Jesus said to them, I tell you the truth. At the renewal of things, when the Son of Man sits on His glorious throne, you who have followed me will also sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And everyone who has left houses or brothers or sisters or fathers or mothers or children or fields for my sake will receive it 100 times over as much and will inherit eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and many who are last will be first. I want you to listen to those words again, okay? Jesus says, those of you who follow me will receive 100 times as much and eternal life. Not in eternal life, and eternal life. You'll get 100 times as much, not in eternal life, not when you get to heaven, but and eternal life. That means right now you can have abundant life. Right here, right now, right today. See, a paraphrase might read like this. Anyone who's made me superior, anyone who submitted to my love, anybody who's sacrificed for my ways and the ways of the Father, anyone who's been willing to give up everything to be a deeply committed follower, to be my disciple, will get back 100 times more in this life and in the next life. And don't misunderstand what I'm saying. This isn't a promise to have a trouble-free life. Jesus already told us we're not going to have a trouble-free life. And it's not a promise you're going to have lots of money in the bank. I'm not trying to speak of prosperity gospel. I'm not trying to teach health and wealth or naming and claiming or blabbing and grabbing. I'm not trying to teach any of those things. I'm just saying, Jesus says, I promise you, you'll get to enjoy things in this life and the next life. I'm not saying you're going to get the creature comforts of the world. It's simply a promise that if you truly decide to become one of my followers, it will be the best decision you've ever made in your entire life.
Amen.
In this life and in the next life. There's a question he asked, and we're going to begin to close with this. It says a question that keeps him awake at night. I have to admit, it's a question that keeps me awake at night. I hope that maybe it's a question. If I'm really carrying the cross, if I'm truly carrying the cross of Jesus Christ, and there's no suffering, and there's no sacrifice, am I really carrying a cross? When's the last time following Jesus cost you anything at all? Take a second and ask yourself, has following Jesus ever cost you anything? There's no sacrifice involved. If you're not at least a little bit uncomfortable, then there's a good chance you're not carrying a cross. And I don't want you to leave here thinking we need to be burdened down, that we need to leave here feeling bad all the time. That's not what this message is about. I don't want you to think that following Jesus is uncomfortable, because that's not true. That's not the message at all. It's simply a message of reality. Jesus didn't call us to be comfortable. He didn't call us to sit on the sidelines and sit in the church and wave other people on and to cheer Him on. their feet to be washed. Poor feet. People who are dying and going to an eternal place of damnation. There's people in this community who need hope. The only hope that Jesus can find. They're turning to drugs. They're turning to sex. They're turning to all these other things. And there's hope in Jesus Christ. And we're the ones that are supposed to take it to them. He wants to work on our character. He wants us to apply what we know so we don't deny ourselves. God wants Christ formed in us. And that's going to involve a little bit of suffering, a little bit of sacrifice, a little bit of submission, some issues of superiority. Not that it's going to be easy, but it will be worth it. Not that it's easy, but it's still the best choice. So as you leave here today, I want you to think about the overreaching question theme of this entire series. Are you a fan of Jesus, just cheering him on? Or are you a follower of Jesus, doing the work of Jesus? Or how we put it last week, are you just a Christian, or are you something more? Or are you a disciple of Jesus? What kind of Christianity have we become comfortable with? Have we made the cross something that it was never intended to be? Are we willing to make Jesus superior to everything that we have, everything and everybody? Are we willing to submit to Jesus even if it means that we have to pick up our own cross and carry it every day, not one time, but all the time? Are we willing to follow Jesus even if we have to give up everything? As we close, I want you to think about this. Jesus takes this horrible thing, this cross, this instrument of execution, and he transforms it into something beautiful. Jesus takes this symbol, this cross of death, and he makes it a symbol of redemption and salvation. Jesus redeeming our sinful lives by the sacrifice of his sinless life and giving us the offer of salvation. Question is, have you ever accepted his offer? Have you ever taken Jesus up on his offer of salvation? If you haven't, make today the day of your salvation. Let today be the day that you're redeemed. The price has already been paid. You know, the altar's open. Just let Jesus know that you'll allow him to be your Savior, your Redeemer, your Messiah. He died for you publicly. Confess your love for him publicly. But I know most of you have already made that decision. You've already done that. But have you made Jesus more than your Savior? Have you made him Lord over your lives? See, we have a tendency as Christians to look at the beautiful side of the cross. And get comfortable. Look at the side that offers salvation. And we make the cross comfortable. We don't like to struggle with the uncomfortable side, do we? Somebody once told me, no matter how thin a pancake is, it's got two sides. We don't look at the other side of the Word of God, it makes us sort of feel uncomfortable, do we? We don't look at what the cross crossed Jesus. So therefore, we just try to make Christianity comfortable. And when we become fans, and we become cheering Jesus on, and we stop being followers in the field. We stop being his hands and his feet. You think about this. Who else but God could take a cross that symbolized the end result of defeat and make it into something victorious? Who else but God could take a cross, which was a symbol of guilt and shame, and turn it into a symbol of grace and mercy? Who else but God could take a symbol of condemnation and make it a symbol of freedom? Who else but God could take a cross, a symbol of pain and suffering, and turn it into a symbol of healing and hope? Who else could take a cross, an instrument of death, and turn it into an instrument of life? Here's the point I want to leave you with. Every message should have a so what moment. This is the so what moment in today's message. What God did for the cross he can do for you.
That's right.
What God did for the cross, he can do for you. He can take your weakest point, he can make it strong. He can take your broken life and put it together and do something incredibly beautiful with it. He can take your loneliness and give you fellowship. He can take your life that has no life and no direction and give it meaning and a purpose. But he can't do it unless we make Jesus more than a Savior. He can't do it unless we make Jesus superior to everybody and everything. He can't use us if we don't submit even to the cross. We can't have the abundant life that he desires, that he's promised us. Not the comfortable life, but the abundant life. We aren't willing to give up everything for him. If we don't do that, we're just fans cheering Jesus on. If we aren't willing to give up everything, Jesus says we can't follow him. We can't be his disciple. Because God loves us, he invites us to follow his son. Are you a fan or are you a follower of Jesus? Let me pray for you. Heavenly Father, do for us what you did for the cross. Father, do for me. Do for this church. Do for this community. Do for this nation. Do for this world. Do for those that are in here this morning what you did for the cross. So that we might begin to understand why you chose such an uncomfortable means of self-sacrifice. Do for us what you did for the cross. Give us the power, Lord, when we have no power, to make you superior. Father, help us to submit to you and your will and to give up our ways and our will. And Father, help us to sacrifice, even if it means us giving up everything. Father, we love you. Our heart's desires are right. Give us the power to do what we cannot do. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, by the authority of the Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, amen. God bless you all. Have a great week. May the peace of the Lord be upon you wherever you go.